And we do have our fingers crossed this Sunday that all our tech is going to work. We just hope every Sunday. The announcements I have, the first one is that this Wednesday is the first day in Lent. It's Ash Wednesday. And so we'll be here at 6:30. If you remember a couple of years ago, how we used to do Ash Wednesday, how we did it when I got here is kind of guided station, or some parts guided and some parts stations around the sanctuary where you could do your own reflection. I'm seeing this as kind of a mini retreat or time of renewal for folks, just for an hour on Ash Wednesday from 6:30 to 7:30. The choir will be here doing a couple of pieces in amongst all that we do, but it's very relaxed and really allows time for people to reflect on and to make. That's the other thing. We found that people like to be able to use their hands for things too. So there's going to be opportunities to create a journal, a prayer journal for Lent at that time. And there's beads and ribbon and colored pencils and I don't know, whatever I can think of to put out for people. So come join us from 6:30 to 7:30. Kids are welcome too. Like I said, there'll be art supplies and little journals that they can make too. So if you want to do that, you're more than welcome to. The other big announcement that we have, because we have postponed this, I think, twice already, is the Piscintu Choir is coming here on Saturday, March 19, if it doesn't snow, at 4 p.m. And that is an immigrants' children's choir that's from here in Maine. And it is the word itself that I got written out for me, thank you, Lynn, so I can say it, is Passamaquoddy for when she sings, her voice carries far. And it's an all-girl choir made up of immigrants who have, are new Mainers who have come here. So we'll be putting a lot out about this, posters up, emails, posts on Facebook and Instagram. Anything that you see, you know, on your Facebook feeds or something like that, if you can just hit share and share it with all your friends or any other pages that you have, that would be really great. And if you don't know how to do that, we can show you how to do that. Just to get the word out, with all the COVID craziness, we've got kind of a short window here. We'll be putting an ad in the paper, you know, doing what we can. But we're so excited to have those girls here and hear their voices and their stories and have them share that with us. John, it looks like you have something you'd like to say.
It's always been an interest of mine to have the entire congregation be part of the choir. And today is your chance. Our anthem today is one that involves the congregation participation. So the song Good Trouble, when we get to the song Good Trouble, please join in. It's a very simple melody, and the words are very simple. The first verse is, this day has challenged us to make good trouble. And the second second part of the refrain is, our faith has challenged us to make good trouble. The words you probably will recognize are by the great representative John Lewis, and we're singing it in recognition of Black History Month. So please join us and sing with us. And if you have a great time, there's always Thursday night, you can come and sing in the choir.
Thank you, John. All right, let's gather together and let's worship. Wherever you are, whoever you are, whatever you come with, wherever you are going, you are seen, you are heard, you are welcome, and you have always belonged. For thousands of years, Indigenous people have walked on this land, on their own land. Their relationship with the land is at the center of their lives. We acknowledge these lands upon which we worship as the ancestral, cultural, traditional, and unceded lands of the Wabanaki Confederacy of the Ndakina people. We commit ourselves to the work of dismantling the ongoing legacies of settler colonialism. And let's stand together and sing our first hymn, Glory, Glory, Hallelujah. Please stand if you're able.
Glory, glory, hallelujah, since I laid my Shouting hallelujah since I laid my burdens down. I am dancing, Miriam's dance now since I laid my burdens down. I am dancing, Miriam's dance now.
We come to you as a people bringing burdens, and you say, let's share them. Let's work on these together. Let's see them not as a way that we fail in this life, but as a way we know what we need to do, how we need to work, how we need to be your love in this world. Gracious God, thank you for bearing these burdens with us, walking with us and loving us. All this we ask in your name. Amen. If you're standing, you may be seated. The poem that I picked for today, this last Sunday of Black History Month, and yet not the last time at all that we will use poems by African Americans. I thought of Elizabeth Alexander. She is an incredible poet. This poem that we have today is the one that she wrote for Obama's first inaugural, right? She was the first poet. And it's just such a marvelous poem. I think many poems, if we do have them, some of them have become famous, you know, Robert Frost, as he stood hatless there in the breeze for Kennedy's inauguration, reciting his when the papers blew away. And of course, you know, we remember Amanda's, Gortman's, who we just had. But this one too is pretty amazing and reminds us of what we need to do in this day. And praise song for the day. I thought too, as we were hearing of war and now war has come too, that we need to remember to praise the day that we have. And that reminds us of the fullness of life that we can have if we work together, if we really are a people of praise and gratitude to the one who gives us this day and every day. And hoping to hear this, not in a way of, aren't we lucky? But rather, this is what God calls us to work for. So let's gather together. And if you would, ground yourself on whatever, with your feet on whatever ground you are on, with your seat in your seat. And find your breathing. Each day we go about our business, walking past each other, catching each other's eyes or not, about to speak or speaking. All about us is noise. All about us is noise and bramble, thorn and din, each one of our ancestors on our tongues. Someone is stitching up a hem, darning a hole in a uniform, patching a tire, repairing things in need of a repair. Someone is trying to make music somewhere with a pair of wooden spoons on an oil drum with cello, boombox, harmonica, voice. A woman and her son wait for the bus. A farmer considers the changing sky. A teacher says, take out your pencils, begin. We encounter each other in words, words spiny or smooth, whispered or declaimed, words to consider, reconsider. We cross dirt roads and highways that mark the will of someone and then others who said, I need to see what's on the other side. I know there's something better down the road. We need to find a place where we are safe. We walk into that which we cannot yet see. Say it plain that many have died for this day. Sing the names of the dead who brought us here, who laid the train tracks, built the bridges, picked the cotton and the lettuce, built brick by brick the glittering edifices they would then keep clean and work inside of. Praise song for struggle, praise song for the day, praise song for every hand-lettered sign and figuring it out at kitchen tables. Some live by love thy neighbor as themselves. Others by first do no harm or take no more than you need. What if the mightiest word is love? Love beyond marital, filial, national, love that casts a widening pool of light, love with no need to preempt grievance. In today's sharp sparkle, this winter air, anything can be made, any sentence begun. On the brink, on the brim, on the cusp. Praise song for walking forward in that light. Loving God, the mightiest word is love. It's not hate, it's not violence, it's not injustice. It is love, and it is you. God, may we live that out today and every day. May we do the hard work and recognize the work that has come before us so that we can be here and make peace in this world. All this we ask in your name. Amen. Are there any more kids that want to come forward? And I see that Cal, now that he's been baptized and was up front last Sunday, he just thinks that he should be preaching. He is going to be like so full. The only way they can get him to stop was to give him a bottle. And he is going to be so full by the end of worship. I can tell this right now, but he is more than worse. This, I was telling everybody that right before, the first time I got to hold him really was just the other week, right? Before I did his baptism. And I played with him and talked with him and everything. And now when he hears my voice, he's like, oh, I know that woman. I'm going to talk back to her. She likes it when I talk back to her. So, but it's good to see y'all. Did you have a good week? Hi there. Come on up. Come on up. You can sit right here. How does that sound? Do you want to sit next to Theo? You know Theo. You guys have probably shared crayons and stuff like that. Yeah. Well, today we're going to be talking about the name of this Sunday is Transfiguration Sunday. Do you guys ever use the word transfiguration? Yeah. You know what? I don't either, unless I'm talking about this for the most part, you know, this Sunday, right? Well, transfiguration means that something about your shape or form, that's figure, right, has gone through a change. Trans just means across or change or something like that, okay? And the story today, and you guys will always remember this now. Hey there, how are you? I call it, don't tell anyone, I call it Glowy Jesus Sunday. I do. I call it Glowy Jesus Sunday because the story goes that Jesus had given his disciples, you know, those guys that, and people that hang out with them. We think it was more than just guys.
He got killed by the cross.
I know. Yeah. That's where he died. We got 6 weeks and then we're going to really tell that story a lot, right? Yeah. I know. Whoops. You want to sit down, hon? Okay. You go get something. So anyway, he told his disciples, go and heal people, go and tell people the good news that God loves them and everything. And the disciples kind of did. Kind of like us, right? We kind of try to do it sometimes, right? We do the best we can, right? So it wasn't going well, but Jesus just needed a little time to go by himself. So he goes up to a mountain, takes a few disciples with him and stuff. And while he's up there, all of a sudden, they say the glory of God just shone on him and he was bright. And then the disciples said they saw two other people up there with him, Moses and Elijah. Now, Moses was from a long time ago and he was, do you? Oh, that's good. Yeah. Two books. Good. Those are good stories about him, right? Yeah. And there's Moses, who'd been dead for 1,000 years at least, right? And Elijah, he was a prophet. He told people, come on back to God. Come on back to God. Yeah, there's lots of stories about Jesus. I'm going to tell you one today, and then you can tell me another one later, okay? How's that sound? That sounds good. Good deal. So then Elijah shows up, or the disciples see what looks like Elijah. The thing is, the story we have about Elijah is that he never died. That a fiery chariot comes and swoops him up. That's what people saw and took him up to heaven. Oh my goodness, right? So it's these two guys that had been, this is about, they said, who had been in the presence of God. Moses went up to get up to the top of a mountain to get the Ten Commandments. And when he came down, he kind of glowed a little bit, they said, because he had been in the presence of God. And here they were saying, they're trying to say that this is what they saw Jesus, like that Jesus had been in the presence of God. You know what hold on just a minute. You know what the amazing thing is though, you guys? We're all glowy. You're glowy, you're glowy, you're glowy, you're glowy, y'all are glowy. You know why? Because we're all in the presence of God all the time. God isn't like off, you know, having dinner somewhere and then shows up occasionally, right? God is with us all the time. And you know when we glow? When we show love, when we show God's love. That's when I think even other people can see us glow. Right? Because we always are glowy, but sometimes it's hard to see, especially if we're being mean or if we're just standing back and going, yeah, I'm just not going to do anything, you know? But when we decide to love people, we glow just like Jesus on Transfiguration Day. Does that sound good? You think you can let that inside glow come out so everybody can see it? I think it's a good idea too. And I know I've seen it and all of you do that. So let's do it some more. How does that sound? All right, let's pray. Gracious God, we have these wild stories about people glowing and people who are dead showing up and all this stuff. And the story actually comes down to that you want us to love. You want us to glow with your love anytime we can. God, let those fantastic, magical stories remind us that we can do something everywhere we are to be your love. All this we ask in your name. Amen. All right. Thanks, y'all. Claire and Julia, you have your hands full today.
Remember when Moses put the lamb's blood on the door?
He did, right. And the angels passed right over. Good job. Wow. Who remembers their Passover story? He's got it down.
Guide my feet.
Our scripture reading this morning is from the book of Luke. And as I told the children, we're just reading 28 through 42. But at the very front of that story is when Jesus does turn to his disciples and says, I am giving you power and authority, those two words, power and authority to heal people and to speak the good news of the kingdom of God. So that's what Jesus has done. And then a bunch of stuff happens. And this is where we pick Jesus up again. Now, about 8 days after these sayings, so the disciples have had some time with this power and authority now, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and went up on a mountain to pray. And while Jesus was praying, the appearance of his face changed, as did his clothes, and they became dazzling white. Suddenly, the disciples saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking with Jesus. And they appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now, Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep. But since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving, Peter said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let's make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Not knowing what he said, which would be a phrase to use with Peter quite routinely, not knowing what he said. And while he was saying this, while Peter was finding his words, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. And then from the cloud came a voice that said, This is my child, my chosen. Listen to him. And when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent, which is the nicest way to say that. And in those days, they told no one of any of the things that they had seen. The next day, when they came down from the mountain, a great crowd met him. And then a man from the crowd shouted, Teacher, I beg you to look at my son. He's my only child. Suddenly, a spirit seizes him, and at once he shrieks, and it convulses him, and he foams at his mouth, and it mauls him, and it will scarcely leave him alone. I begged your disciples to cast it out, but they could not. And Jesus answered, You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you and bear you? Oh, bring your son here. While he was coming, the demon dashed him to the ground in convulsions. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. May God bless these words to our living. Quite a story, huh? This transfiguration, like, why do I keep skipping it, right? With a story like this. And as I said to the kids, I do lovingly call it Glowy Jesus Sunday. And I met a woman years ago who lived in the same town I did. She was Catholic, but happened to be in town, and we were the only church in town. So she came on Transfiguration Sunday. And when I used those words, I thought I was going to offend her. She just started laughing. And often on Transfiguration Sunday, she will Facebook me and say, Remember when you called it Glowy Jesus Sunday? So I know it's an image, like these poor kids are going to always think Transfiguration means Glowy Jesus Sunday. And I'll have to admit, I never really got it the way that it was always explained to me. It was this whole theological thing, you know, and it's also part of Jesus moving from death to resurrection. One of the reasons he needed to go out alone up on the mountain was that right before this, they have him speaking about his death, about what is going to be coming. And his disciples always got really nervous when he did that, you know, and Peter even, you know, at one point, you know, the famous line to Peter, get behind me, Satan, you know, was done because Peter was trying to tell Jesus, don't talk about that death thing. It's not good for the crowd. You know, they're not going to like this. But Jesus, like us, is moving to his death every day. So are we. I mean, that's a really bad way to think about it, but we do. We live in life. But that's not what this whole story is about, I think, or could be for all of us. And again, here they are intertwining, what great storytellers, intertwining Jesus with Moses and Elijah, who are by this point revered. But if we're honest about both of those people, they were just hot messes, okay? You know, they're in our canon, their stories are there. And if we really read them, they're not only amazing, but they're a mess. But we like our leaders to be dazzling, don't we? Literally. We like to see them there. And if their power is somehow beyond the power of our meager selves, that they can do much more than we can do. But we found out that's often not the case, is it? And I don't think that just that putting Jesus in line with Elijah and Moses is a good enough reason to tell this story, to stand back and admire, because that's not what we're called to do. But I think it works well on this Sunday. It happens to, and I say that about like every scripture. I'm like, oh yeah, I can make that work with this. But I think it works well with the piece of the prayer that we have today from the Holden prayer, just three words, give us faith. And much like I argue with the usual interpretation of Transfiguration Sunday, I am going to argue with those three words. I beg to differ with give us faith. When I saw that and read that, and I know we say that a lot, asking God to give us faith, but I think it's a big cop-out. I have no problem with faith, except that we're often afraid of it. We think that it's blind faith, and there's nothing further than the truth about faith than it's blind. It isn't blind trust. It isn't blind faith. Faith is hard work where we try to be God's presence of love in this world. And sometimes we get it right, and sometimes we do not. And it's doing the work that makes faith. Faith doesn't happen by osmosis. It's not like COVID that we just breathe it in, right? It is hard work. And the two glowies that showed up with Jesus proved how hard of work it is to make faith in our lives. Moses. Remember the story of Moses? We should have just had Tucker tell us the story of Moses, it appears. I am so impressed when the kids can tell me stories back. I love that. But because he had part of it, you know, he had part of it. But remember, Moses was living in two worlds. He was born a Hebrew child, but his sister was smart enough to make a basket for him and stick him in the water. And the Egyptian princess was snarky enough to her father to bring home an obviously Hebrew baby and call him hers, raise him in the palace. And even though Moses went back to his own mother to be nursed and stuff like that, he was still having to live in two worlds and grew up living in those two worlds. And what happens when you live in two worlds? You are a resident of neither, right? You don't really know where your home is. I thought of that yesterday with the Ukrainians talking about first being refugees in their own land and then going to Poland, you know, and any place that they could get to. But now they have no home. You know, their home is somewhere back there, but they're not there. It's not going to be the same when they return and all of this. That's what Moses lived every single day. And listen to his pedigree. He kills an Egyptian to stop a beating. He runs away. He's a totally reluctant leader. That's how Aaron gets in the picture. He works so hard to be patient with the people. I don't think Moses was a patient guy. And he didn't particularly listen well either. Remember, he never gets to go into the land of Canaan. And you know, the reason I looked it up again, just to make sure that that's what I remembered, it's because he had to provide water for the people. They were complaining again. And God said, take your staff and whack the rock. Or no, that's the opposite. Moses, God says, say these words to the people and water will flow. And Moses instead took his stick and whacked the rock. And God said, what? My words aren't good enough for you? Moses worked on making his faith his entire life. And Moses' glowy moment that he had in his own life, when he was up in the mountain in the presence of God, when he came down, he started veiling his face because that glow was diminishing and he didn't want people to think that it was going away. His assumption was the only reason people listened to him was because of that party trick that his face glowed. He did have a hard time thinking that God's words and God's presence had power. But he was changed in God's presence. And Elijah, well, Elijah was also a mess too. He also enjoyed whining, as we all do. And he was on the run a lot of time because of remember King Ahab and Jezebel? You know, the great Jezebel story, of course, is, you know, Elijah was so scared of Jezebel and God said, you know what? No, Jezebel's going to have her end and only the palms of her hands are going to be left. And indeed, when she was pushed over the wall, that's the only thing the dogs left. Yeah. Favorite story of all fifth grade boys. But Elijah just, you know, he ran all the time. You know, he was the one in the cave that God had to come to him. In the sound of sheer silence. Elijah was the one who went and hung out with the widow and the son. And remember, the widow had only enough flour and oil to make one last cake for her and her son. And then they were going to basically lay down and starve to death. And Elijah said, no, make me that cake. And you will never run out. Thinking of that story the other day, guess who had the most faith in that situation? The widow. Would you have made a last cake for a stranger and then had the faith every morning to pick up the canister of flour and the jug of oil and go, ooh, we got one more day, people. Elijah wasn't making the bread. The widow was. He had to learn from her how to do this, how to let his life be shaped by God. And of course, he went up in that chariot of fire. So that's why I think he gets back and gets his glowy moment too. Because he didn't, you know, as we have in our story say, he never died. But he had to work in God's presence every single moment. And so do we. And Jesus gets really testy at the end of the story. They don't tell that much, right? The story, do they? You know, it is true. We often do like a very gentle Jesus, though then we ended up with a really militaristic Jesus that we're living with, it seems, out in popular culture right now. But he does. He's like, Jesus is done. Like, that mountain experience was not enough to renew him, was it? He had given his disciples the power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases and to proclaim the kingdom of God. That's what it says in those first verses. And actually, proclaiming the kingdom of God was more radical and more dangerous than anything else they could have done, especially in that political climate. And then they couldn't help a boy. They couldn't return him back to health. They couldn't give him to his father in a way where they didn't have to watch him all the time. I don't think we have the power of instant healing. We do have some pretty amazing medical things that we can do, but we do have the power to heal if we work our faith. If we don't wait around for some gift from God. The father begged. Did you hear that? He begged. Because they would not act. And Jesus called them and us to a faithless and perverse generation. What Jesus was basically saying is, get off your keisters, folks. Get moving. If you saw this little boy having these seizures and foaming in his mouth, and y'all stepped back because you were scared, Jesus said, that's not the way we do it. We step toward that. Maybe we want to say instead of give us faith, Jesus, tell us how. Tell us how you really want us to do this. Remind us again so that our transfiguration can happen. Because that's what we're called to, not to stand and admire this story and the glowiness or the amazingness of these disciples' visions that get written down, but for us to have the experience of both Jesus and the disciples, to work our faith so that we see others glow and we say, wow. And so that we hear from others, wow, there's something strange about you. You don't act like you used to. You don't do, why'd you take that step? And we got lots to heal, don't we? Loneliness, injustice, violence, cynicism, war. Make your list. It will take all day. We have been given power over what separates us from each other and from our true selves. And the job of proclaiming with all that we are and all that we do, that the kingdom of God's love is now. It's not going to be up on some mountain where we have our glowy moment or our transfiguration. It's every day in a million ways as we choose love over hate, action over inaction, justice over injustice, faith over fear, because that's the opposite of faith, is fear. Transfiguration isn't just a Jesus story. It's ours. It's working our faith, putting ourselves in those places, making those choices to love and to risk and to trust. Let's get out there and glow. Let's pray. Loving God, the gift has been given. The gift of our lives, of your love, it's already been given to us. So give us a push. Give us eyes that see the places you want us to act, for they're right there in front of us. We're already in the middle of them. God, remind us that we have the courage, that we have the strength, that we have what we need to be your people of love in this world. All this we ask in your name. Amen. And if you're able, please stand and we will sing our song, We Shall Overcome.
We shall overcome. a day very soon. If you're standing, you may be seated. Just doing that together on this morning. When we know our siblings in Ukraine, in many places, are only huddling in basements or subway tunnels, are not at the place where they may have gone to church or may have just gathered to sing. May we listen for their voices as they sing their national anthem, as they sing songs that if we knew Ukraine, we might recognize. Indeed. Imagine on this Sunday, it's not just who we can be as a congregation, but imagine what this world can be as a place of peace. Let us indeed, as we gather our gifts together, give in that spirit and in that promise to work for peace. Loving God, we give. We give, most of us, because we're able to. We give from our extra. God, let us give our whole selves. Let us give even what we think we do not have. Let us give it all in the work of your love and your peace. All this we ask in your name. Amen. If you're standing, you may be seated. And let us continue together, joining our voices together in this universal prayer of peace. Loving God, lead us from death to life.
From falsehood to truth.
Lead us from despair to hope.
From fear to trust.
Lead us from hate to love.
From war to peace.
Let peace fill our heart, our world, our universe.
Peace, peace, peace.
And loving God, as once again we as humans have chosen war over peace, we pray for the people of Ukraine who remain in their homes, in towns, cities, and the countryside. Loving God, may they know your presence. For the people of Ukraine who have left their homes and are now refugees in their own country. Loving God, may they know your presence. For the people of Ukraine who have left their country and are now refugees in a neighboring land. Loving God, may they know your presence. For those around the world who have loved ones in Ukraine. Loving God, may they know your presence. For the people of Russia, in whose name this violence is being done, and who are demonstrating at their peril. Loving God, may they know your presence. For those working to protect freedom and lives. Loving God, may they know your presence. For those who have been trained and told to take lives. Loving God, may they know your presence. For the leaders of this world who are working for peace and struggling to work for peace, loving God, may they know your presence. For the leaders of this world who are not working for peace, loving God, We pray for them, and may they know your presence. We come this morning, God, knowing that we also need to ask for forgiveness from you, from the people of Ukraine and the world, for thinking of ourselves first instead of others, for not being willing to do the hard work of peace, for thinking that we are insulated from the effects of war and violence, for thinking that the words of leaders don't really matter, that they're just words. Loving God, turn our hearts to your love. God, as these events that surround us, this tragedy that is occurring, fills our TVs and radios, our newspapers, our internet, God, we remember too that we need to make peace also where we are. That as we do that and practice that in the ways that are right before us, we will be transfiguring this world in your love and peace. For all those places that are before us, God, send us. For those places that we want to stay away from because they scare us, God, remind us of the faith that you work with us in building in our lives. Gracious God, for all those people who feel like their needs and their sorrows and hurts are being overshadowed by what is happening to this world, God, let us remember them. Let us take the time to see them and hear them and be your presence with them. For all the ways that we can do that and will do that in the days to come, God, we thank you now for that work that we need to do. And hear us as your people, as we join our voices together so that we can practice joining our lives together as we leave this place. And pray the prayer that you teach us through. Eternal Spirit, Earth Maker, Pain Bearer, Life Giver, Source of all that is and that shall be, Parent of us all, Loving God, in whom is heaven. The hallowing of your name echo through the universe. The way of your justice be followed by the peoples of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us. In the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen. Before we sing our final hymn, I want to, one more announcement we have. We have book club for Beyond Worship today. Please join us in the Gorham room for that. And it will also, there's a link in Friday's Blast online if you'd like to join us that way too. Let's stand together and sing. If you stand, if you're able, and sing, I Want to Be Ready. And if you will sing everything but the leader parts, that you sing the refrain and all, and Allie's going to be our leader for this one.
Walk in Jerusalem just like John. I want to be ready. come and see. Walk in Jerusalem just like John. Her faith gave Lazarus victory.
I'm in Jerusalem just like John. I want to be ready.
Was just four square.
Walk in Jerusalem just like John.
And he declared he'd meet me there.
Walk in Jerusalem just like John. I want to be ready. I want to be ready. I want to be ready. Walk in Jerusalem just like John.
Whether it's Jerusalem, or here, or any place we go, we are ready. God has been working on our faith with us since moment one, since before we took breath. And what we have is what is needed. So let us use that in this world. And indeed, may God's peace be with you now and always. Amen.